A new study just out looked at the effect of different diets on COVID, and it's making the headlines. People on plant-based diets, which included whole food plant-based and vegetarian, were 73% less likely to get moderate to severe COVID symptoms. And if that wasn't provocative enough, they also found that people on low-carb or high-protein diets were almost 4 times more likely to get moderate to severe COVID than the plant-based folks. Now, obviously the media had a field day with this. They were on it like white on rice. And on social media, we saw the usual polarization with some people celebrating the study and others completely dismissing it. That's par for the course. So let's take an objective look at the data and see what we can glean from all of this. The first thing to bear in mind is the type of study, the experimental design. Now, if you've seen some of our previous videos, you might be familiar with the three bags of evidence, or as one viewer recently called them, the three sacks of evidence. Sacks is way funnier. Bag one are lab studies in test tubes or mice, for example. Interesting data, but they require confirmation in humans. Bag two are observational studies, basically looking for trends in populations. Also interesting, but ideally you want to triangulate them with clinical trials, bag three. So this COVID study falls squarely in bag two. It's observational, which means we have to tread carefully because the diets were not assigned by the researchers. They were chosen by the participants. And that can open the door to potential confounders. People who eat more plants may also choose to exercise more and smoke less, for example. Now, unlike what you hear very often on social media, the existence of potential confounders doesn't mean the study and the data is useless. That's a common misunderstanding. The scientists who run these studies are well aware of these issues and they try to adjust for them using statistical models. In this study, they adjusted for age, sex, race, nationality, smoking, physical activity, BMI, and a number of conditions like diabetes, high cholesterol, high blood pressure, heart disease, cancer, and lung diseases. This statistical adjustment means they try to remove those factors from the equation and ask if the observed effect still survives. And in this case, it did for the most part, which suggests it wasn't explained by any of those confounders. Now, these adjustments are crucial, and any observational study worth its salt nowadays includes them. But they're not perfect. There's always a possibility of residual confounding. Also, there can be additional confounders that are not included in the models and not accounted for at all. For example, maybe the people on plant-based diets are more health conscious in general, so they're more careful about social distancing, and they expose themselves to a lower virus load, and they get less sick as a result. That's very difficult to adjust for, unlike something like smoking, which is much more cut and dry. That's just one example. Because of this potential for confounding, observational studies, bag two, they're interesting data, they're valuable information, but they're usually not very good at determining causality. Factor A causes factor B. And this is very commonly misunderstood and misstated. Take a look at this article describing the study, for example. Vegan diet reduces COVID symptoms. That's language of causality. It's assuming that the diet directly causes the outcome. This can seem like a subtle difference, but it's important. The headline also specifies vegan, but the study didn't report results for vegans. Whole food plant-based and vegetarian were lumped together, so there's no way for us to know what happened in vegans specifically. It's entirely possible that in the vegan group, there was no significant effect. We just don't know. So you see how the crafting of these headlines and the interpretations of the study stretch the facts. This one is on a site called vegnews.com, so I guess that kind of makes sense. A more accurate headline would be something like, study finds association between plant-based diets and severity of COVID symptoms. But of course, that's not as catchy. Their subtitle is a bit more accurate in much smaller print. Here are some more reactions to the study from social media. Vegan diet cuts COVID risk. Low-carb diet increases risk. Same misunderstandings of the headline, implying causality and specifying vegan and low carb, which we don't know from the study. Sounds about right. So it confirms a previous view, which motivates the extrapolation. We have to be very careful with this. Here's one leaning in the opposite direction from someone who calls himself keto something. What a load of crap. This one has colorful language. There's no way vegans have a stronger immune system than meat eaters. That's a fact. Notice he's not criticizing anything about the study itself, the experimental design. He just dislikes what he perceives as the bottom line. In fact, he's linking a news piece. There's a good chance he didn't see the study itself, but it must be wrong because it doesn't align with prior views. By the way, I don't know any of these people, so this isn't a jab at anyone in particular. I just searched Twitter and this is what popped up. And I didn't handpick tweets either. The bulk of the hits were along these lines, kind of very emotionally charged and leaning strongly in one direction or another, overclaiming or dismissing. And the risk with this mindset is that in a field like medicine, if we decide which information we accept based on whether it aligns with our views, we pay the toll with our own health. It can literally be life and death. Plenty of examples, recent ones all around us. Vaccines, COVID, diet, statins, other drugs, you name it. Our perspective of scientific information directly impacts our health. My PhD advisor used to say that if the data doesn't make sense, be suspicious. But if the data makes perfect sense, be more suspicious, because it's our nature to favor conclusions that support our beliefs. So, to protect ourselves, we try to apply the same criteria, same MO, almost like a machine, to all incoming information, whether we like the message or not. Okay, another issue with the study. We always have to be very clear about exactly what is being measured. They classified a case of COVID as anyone with a positive test or anyone with symptoms compatible with COVID. So we don't really know how many participants truly had COVID. Now, they did run a separate analysis just on the people with a positive test, and there was no significant difference in COVID severity between people on different diets, which weakens the main conclusions of the paper a bit. The trend was still there, but it didn't reach statistical significance. Now, maybe it's because the number of people, what we call N, was smaller. Obviously, it's a subset, but yeah, it wasn't significant. The only significant difference in this analysis, looking only at people with a positive confirmed test, was that the odds of getting infected with COVID in the first place were lower for people on whole food, plant-based, vegetarian, and pescatarian when the three were combined into one group. The other consideration is what people actually ate. Different people mean different things when they say low carb or plant-based or even vegan. Yep, I'm low carb. Well, lower than yesterday. What do you want from me? People on plant-based diets reported eating more vegetables, more legumes and nuts, but less poultry and red and processed meat than average, which makes sense. But they also consumed less sugar-sweetened beverages and alcohol than average, which goes with whole food plant-based, I guess. Not necessarily with vegetarianism, it depends, but it's just good to bear in mind all of these factors, all of these moving pieces. Additional healthy behaviors in these populations beyond just the meat avoidance that characterizes plant-based diets. As for the low-carb and or high-protein group, it's even more problematic to make sense of that data. First, because it's a very heterogeneous pairing. They basically combined the two categories into one group, but that could mean wildly different diets. When we look at actual foods reported, this group of low-carb and or high-protein did eat less refined grains and less sweets and desserts than average. But they still consumed sugar-sweetened beverages an average of 2.6 times a week, sweets or desserts 5 times a week, and refined grains almost 7 times a week in average. Every day is a cheat day, I guess. I'm joking around, but you see the problem with calling this a low-carb diet and just concluding, hey, did you see that study? Low-carb diets raise your risk of COVID, like we saw in some of the social media reactions. So you see how the different loose ends raise the level of uncertainty. And this is how you generally evaluate scientific evidence. You don't dismiss studies outright, but you kind of gauge the level of confidence. And that goes up depending on experimental design, depending on the rigor of the study, and especially based on accumulating evidence over time, consistently pointing in a given direction. So, bottom line, does this study demonstrate that plant-based diets protect against COVID? No. Does it raise that possibility? Sure. We'll see if future studies with other experimental designs, with more precision, align with this or not. Should you go eat more plants because of this study? No. Lots of evidence-based, compelling reasons to eat a diet rich in plants, whether it's high carb, low carb, intermediate carb, but this study would not be at the top of that list. Hope that helps. Let us know if other studies pop up that you find confusing. Catch you on the next one. Peace.